as Asushi mentioned, this is my fourth lecture. So let me just remind you just briefly what had been done so far. I think in the first lecture, I introduced this construction of automorphic forms. Called Poincare series, okay, and then I formulated I stated the main theorem on globalization of supercuspidal. So this is basically saying that you can given a supercuspidal at a local place of a global field, you can find a cuspidal representation that globalizes it, and such at all other places, the local components of the cuspidal representations belong to the principal series. And moreover, if your supercuspidal is distinguished, you know, with respect to some unipotent subgroup and some character, then you can, for the global cusp forms, you can also ensure these distinguished properties. Okay. And in lecture two, I basically just discussed the proof. So I discussed the proof. And last time, I talked about the applications of this globalization theorem. And the first one is to the Langland-Shahidi theory. So using this globalization result, my co-author, Luis Lomeli, had completed the development of the Langland-Shahidi theory over function fields. Okay? What this theory gives you is basically that it provides for you, it defines for you certain invariants of representations. Okay, so I guess let me just write something just to open define it again. Basically, it defines for you a number, a family of gamma factors, local gamma factors. However, it only works if your representation part is generic. Okay. Now, and then we combine this, you know, all this stuff that goes on before with Vincent Lafforgue's so-called global Langland correspondence. So, okay. So what Lafforgue did was he managed to construct a map from say cuspidal representations of group H to continuous L-adic representations row from so this is over some function field K, global function field. Every pi, and so what does this map? You produce a certain global L-adic Galois representation, and with the property of this map is that at the unramified places, at almost all places, this is compatible with Sadaki isomorphism. And using so we took this as a black box last time. And then combining with our globalization theorem and this Langland-Shahidi theory, we prove at the end the following let's call it proposition, that under this map, for all, so if pi is globally generic, and we with its associated Galois representation rho pi L, then for all places B, so whenever you take any of these, sometimes I would just decorate this with LS, okay, for Langland-Shahidi. You take this Langland-Shahidi gamma factor of the local representation with respect to some, so R is some representation of the L group. It's equal to gamma. So sometimes I would decorate this with gao to indicate that it is a gamma factor on the Galois side. If you take the associated local Galois representation, so here R is some map from the L group to some GL. Of course, I'm not allowed to take any R, but only those R that arise in the Langland-Shahidi theory. Okay, so that was where we stopped last time. Okay, this was the last application that I talked about. And at the end of last time, I mentioned that, what if your representation is not generic? Okay, then you do not have these gamma factors, because the Langland-Shahidi theory only works for generic representations. But I said that there's a causal invariant. So I want to talk about that today. That is a so-called Poincare measure. So the setting is the same as the Langland-Shahidi, which means that you have some group G, say over a local field, and you have a parabolic P, and Levy is our group H, let's say, a unipotent radical. Well then, so you have this. You have pi f, just an irreducible representation of hf, and you see, because this is a Levy subgroup, so it is not semi-simple. There's at least one copy of gm in its center, so you always have lots of one-dimension characters you can twist your representation by. But via this twisting, the set of irreducible representations of H can be thought of as a union of manifolds, if you wish. Okay? So you have a lot of characters. Okay, so let me just say you have a lot of characters that you can choose from. Okay, now for any such thing, you can form the irreducible representation. Usually, people take this to be an unramified character, so that it's kind of a complex family. But then you also have the you can also induce up from the so-called opposite parabolic. I mean, the Levy is the same, so you take the same representation on the Levy, but you look at the opposite parabolic, and then there's a so-called standard intertwining operator. So let me. Give it a name, so M, so this is going from P to PF bar. It will depend on some character psi because its very definition is an integral, and so there's some measure involved, and you need to normalize that measure carefully, and you need some additive character to help you do that. So I won't go into this. There's some so-called standard intertwining operator. Now, of course, you can do it two times in the sense that you will have the analogous thing coming back, right? So, of course, you will write this slightly. You exchange the row of P and P bar. Okay, you will. So then you can consider the composite, okay? And the composite will of course be intertwining operator from this representation to itself. However, for a generic twist or general chi, this induced representation is irreducible. So this means that the composite for most chi, or almost all chi, if you wish, is going to be a scalar operator. Okay. So the definition is you define mu chi f tensor chi f inverse will be the composite of these two. So now this thing is a scalar value function. Okay? I mean, it's a scalar. Okay, so this for generic chi, it is a scalar. But if you think of this chi as varying over a complex manifold, then this becomes a meromorphic function. Okay? So this is a meromorphic function, meromorphic scalar value function. Value function in chi f. Okay, chi f is varying in f. Now, as you might suspect, I mean, these intertwining operators, where they have poles and so on, will tell you something about the reducibility points of this induced representation. Okay, so later, I will state some result. I'll formulate a lemma where I recall some of these properties of this function, which will tell you something about reducibility of this induced representation. I guess I could formulate them now, but why don't I state them when I actually need to use them? Because if I formulate them now, then when I refer to it, then it's, you'll probably be gone from the blackboard by then. Okay, so at the moment, I just make a definition like that. So, in Shahidi's work, in Langland-Shahidi theory, one of the things one show is the following: that if pi f is generic, okay, then okay. So I'm going to forget about the twist. Okay, so. This meromorphic function can be expressed in terms of the Langland-Shahidi gamma factors. So it will be product over I of gamma s I psi gamma minus s. So we recall. What are these RIs? Well, you have this parabolic, right? You can, on the dual side, you can look at the algebra of the dual parabolic, the action of the dual group, or L group, if you wish, and it breaks up into certain irreducible. So forget about the S. S. Okay. The S is if I take this chi f to be something like absolute value to the s, then okay, so it is in this sense that this functional measure is a coarser invariant than the Langland-Shahidi gamma factor, or say it in another way, what the Langland-Shahidi theory achieved is a refinement of this invariant, breaking it up into smaller pieces so that you have more refined invariants. Okay? So if the representation is not generic, you don't have this, but you still have this guy. Okay? And so the first, maybe I want to, so I want to prove the analogous results as what I had in the application. So let me just say there's two statements. So one is that over. So if you have pi 1, pi 2, irreducible representation of HF with the same central character. Then for all sufficiently ramified characters I f we will pi 1 right, and 2 is that if you have a pi, now this global pi is a cuspidal representation with so you have this continuous Galois representation associated by Lafforgue, then for all v, so you'll be analogous to this. Okay, so this is some additive character, okay, global additive character. Then it can be expressed in a, what am I trying to say? So I'm going to write down something that looks like that. Okay, but of course I cannot use the Langland-Shahidi, right? But what I want to do is express it in terms of the Galois sign, because just like what I had over here, creating a representation theoretic invariant, a Galois theoretic one. So here, my representation theoretic invariant is this. On the Galois side, well, I want an analog of that. Okay, so it will be there's a Ri composed with rho ILV by V times Ri. And it is proved in the analogous way. So let me briefly say what I mean by that. Of course, we have to use this globalization theorem. Well, before I do that, let me say, instead of having to write this many times, I'm going to maybe define this to be How about we just do this? Okay, just some shorthands for this thing. I just want to give a sketch proof because it's similar to the proof as the proposition that I did last time. So if you recall, what let's say we do part one, right? So for part one, what happens is if you give me a cuspidal, you can reduce to a supercuspidal case, okay? So assume that you have pi 1 supercuspidal. Then, of course, we use the globalization theorem. We globalize it to a cusp form so that at every other place, it belongs to principal series, the local component. And then, so I have this cuspidal representation. Then I apply Lafforgue's construction to get a global Galois representation. Now, when I was trying to prove this result, basically what I did was I then consider the global functional equation satisfied by the L function of pi as well as of the Galois representation, and then I compare. Right? So over here, what plays the role of this global functional equation of the L function? Well, it will be the global functional equation of the intertwining operator. So the sketch. Proof is, you prove, basically the key is to prove this lemma. So if pi f is a supercuspidal representation of f, then there exists a Langlands parameter, which plays the link group to okay, such that mu psi is equal to mu. Some parameter, okay, so basically this says that this analytic representation theoretic invariant is equal to some Galois theoretic one. And then I would use, if I have this lemma, I will immediately get part one, because I can use on the Galois side, so if I have pi one, pi two, I apply this lemma to both of them, I will get two Galois theoretic thing, and I want to twist them by a highly ramified chi. And the theorem of Lalin and Hanyak would say that they can be made to be equal for a sufficiently ramified twist. So how is this proved? This lemma is proved by using this globalization theorem. As follows, so you have a pi f, right? You globalize to a pi, okay? And then now you are going to, and of course this pi by L.4, you have this pi L. Okay. Step one and step two is going to use a global functional equation of what? Of sort of this standard intertwining operators. What are these? So we have this this induced with this operator. But now you have a global representation with a pi, you will have you also have this induced GP pi, right? To induce P bar G pi. You have a global analog of those local intertwining operators, okay? And the point is that they satisfy this functional equation, P bar P, composed with P bar I, is identity. This is the global functional equation. And this is what will play the role, because another way, if you imagine that this global intertwining operator is the Euler product of the local ones, then this equation, morally speaking, is saying that the product over all V, okay, this product diverges. So, let's pretend is equal to 1. Right? That's what this thing is saying. If you imagine each of these operators is just a Euler product of the local intertwining operators, then we are just saying we are taking the product over all V of the composite. Minus one, but it's the same. Right, so now when you look at this equation, you see that at all other places besides the place where you have your IF, this IV is just a principal series. This functional measure, so-called, it satisfies the analog of this multiplicativity. So since your representation is induced from Borel or some parabolic, you can express this in terms of the using data, so to speak. Okay? And then by induction, you can go to the Galois side, and that's how ultimately you get this. Okay. So I won't go to the details because it's the same type of argument as last time.
So the functional equation for intertwining operator holds for any pi or only pi supercuspidal.
You mean this global one?
Yeah.
I think it basically holds for, I want to say automorphic. But I just assume cuspidal. Yeah. Okay. So anyhow, I spent some time on this functional measure because I'm going to use it quite a bit today. Okay. So. The main thing I want to discuss today is the following question. So since Lafforgue had given you this so-called global Langland correspondence, it is very tempting to try to deduce a local Langland correspondence from it. Okay, by taking the local component. Okay, if you fix a place V and you see that, you know, if you take pi V here and you take the local Galois representation, rho LV, okay, and then you ask whether the rho LV is determined by the pi V. If it is, okay, then you can write down, you know, kind of a local Langland correspondence. Okay, so the question I want to discuss or the goal is: can one use instance of Lafforgue's global Langland correspondence to obtain a local Langland correspondence, which, what is that? Well, it is a map from irreducible representation of a group over a local field, okay, F, to the set of L parameters for HF. Okay, so what is an L parameter? It is a map from a Vedelin group to the L group. So that's what I want to discuss today. And okay, I'm not going to do it in general. I'm going to consider the case when H is a classical group. So let me say more precisely. So, what do I mean by a classical group? It means that. H is the automorphism group, maybe the identity component of the connected component of the automorphism group of some vector space with some form. So this is some finite dimensional vector space over. Okay. So maybe before that, let me say that I have my local field F. I'm going to fix E to be equal to either F or a quadratic extension, separable quadratic extension. Okay. Then I take a vector space over E, and then I take a epsilon Hermitian form. On E, non-degenerate. So of course there are various cases, right? So if F E is equal to F, then this form will be either symmetric or skew symmetric, and then I'm going to get the if it is skew symmetric, I'm going to get symmetric group, right? Otherwise, I'm going to get the special orthogonal group. Okay, if that's if E equals F, if E is a quadratic field, then I'm just going to get unitary group. This will be a Hermitian or skew Hermitian form. Some unitary. So these are the groups that I meant by classical groups. And yeah, so what are their L parameters? Well, for this group, if you look at the Langland's dual group, okay, this guy will be 2n plus 1 c, this guy will be 2n c, this guy will be sc2n c, and this guy will be GLN, the Langland's dual. We need the L group. The L group will be basically almost like this. I mean, you will take a semi-direct product with the V group, right? But But for this classical group, it's simpler just to do the following. So simply just, in this case, because this group is always split, the L group is just a direct product, right, of a dual group with A group. So there's no harm just to forget about that A group part. In this case, the orthogonal group is just this. Well, there will be some semi-direct product. Okay, it's acting by an outer automorphism. Okay, so with that, after explicating this L group, we can consider Langland's parameter. So there are homomorphisms like that which are taken up to conjugacy by the dual group. However, for classical group, it is even easier to think about this because you see, for example, in these three cases, if you have a homomorphism from the Vedalin group to this type of things, then you are going to get a certain natural standard representation of these groups, right? So, for example, if your Langland's parameter goes to goes to this one, right, then you can think of it as a 2n-dimensional representation. Okay. And the fact that it lives inside SP2n means that somehow on this representation, you fix a skew symmetric form. But in fact, you don't lose information when you do that. Okay, so over here, it is less clear, right, because you have a map from Vedalin group to this thing, okay, but I mean, it's not really clear how to write down a representation of this group. But if you restrict this homomorphism to the Vedalin group of E, which is a subgroup of index 2, you will land inside this part, the identity component. And then it's clear you can take the standard representation of that. Okay. So for this classical group, L parameters equivalent classes of representations from Vedalin group of E. When E equals to F, then it's just closer thing to some GL N. Okay, depending on what the N is. Conjugate self-dual of some sign which I call epsilon HF. Okay, actually just to illustrate, just forget, so maybe I make two comments. So one comment was, in this case, right, I said we, instead of thinking of phi as a map from the Vedalin group of F to this, I simply restrict this homomorphism to this subgroup of index 2. And then, you will take value in just the identity component GLNC, which I can then I get an n-dimensional representation. Okay. It would appear that one must be losing some information because you restrict your thing to a subgroup, but in fact, you don't. Okay. In fact, you don't lose any information, and that's why you can think of it that way. Okay, so now forget about this. Just look at the other case when E is F. In each case, okay, so in this case, I'm going to get a 2n plus 1-dimensional representation. And because it takes value in S or 2n, it will be a self-dual of sine plus 1. This similarly here, okay? But for this, it will be a 2n-dimensional representation of sine minus 1. Okay, so that's what this sine is. In the unitary case, okay, you can similarly attach a sine, but just forget about it. Okay, so what I want to say was just that this set of L parameters is very concrete for classical group. It is basically certain finite dimensional representation of the Vedalin group of E with some self-duality properties. Okay. Right. Okay, at this point, maybe one thing that one can start to construct this map, but I want to maybe say even before we start, okay, just from because one consequence of the so one application of the Langland-Shahidi theory. It's actually a partial construction of such a map, such a local Langlands correspondence. Because after you have developed this Langland-Shahidi theory, one of the things that one can show using Langland-Shahidi theory plus the so-called converse theorem of Cocktail and Piazzi Shapiro, one can show a factorialist thing from globally generic cuspidal representation of here my age, I specialize to one of these classical groups henceforth. Okay, so this is one of those classical groups. Let's say automorphic representations of GLN. What is this N? This N is the same N as the one here. So for example, you have a pi, you will get some. What is the property of this functorial lifting? Well, it's basically unramified places. You simply get this the same Sadaki class. Okay? Because at unramified place, your local parameter is an unramified map to GLNC. So it determines the unramified representation of GLNC, of GLN. Okay? So all the unramified place is compatible. So in the characteristic zero case, this was a Cocktail, Kim, Piazzi, Shapiro, and Shahidi in a couple of IHBS papers. In the function two case, this was what Lomeli had done after he developed this, completed this Langland-Shahidi theory over function fields. Now, after you have this, you can, from this, you can get, so from this, one gets a local result. Okay. Which is from generic supercuspidal representations of HF. Supercuspidal representations of GLNF. This is a local theorem that is extracted from this global theorem. When you pick the B component, let's say, you get a statement like that. Okay, so actually you can also extend this to discrete series, but let me not bother with that. Let me just say for supercuspidal, I get something like this. Of course, some work has to go into deducing this local theorem from the global one, because you have to check this is a well-defined thing, independent of globalization. Okay, because if you give me a generic supercuspidal, how is this map defined? I would globalize it to a globally generic cuspidal representation. Okay. So now I have an object here. I would apply this factorial lifting to get some guy here. Then I will pick off the relevant local component. And I get something. I have to check that what I get is something is supercuspidal, okay? And that's because otherwise you just get some representation of GLN, right? And then, and then But even if it is supercuspidal, I have to also check that it is well defined, that it is independent of the way I globalize my supercuspidal. So there's a bunch of things to be checked here. And okay. So after, yeah, so one get a local lifting, okay. And of course here you have the local Langlands correspondence for GLN. Right, we know supercuspidal corresponds to map from this to so by composite, when we compose, we might think we have something like that, which is kind of what we want, right? But I want to land in L parameters for HF, not L parameter for GLN. So I should check that this diagonal arrow, the image is contained in, well, actually there's no irreducible representation of the bagel. So, I should verify that the under the diagonal arrow, the image is contained in the set of maps like that satisfy this condition. Okay, this is not obvious a priori, but this is basically what Arthur has checked. Okay, so over here you have all the phi which are self conjugate to were of sine epsilon h. This is the one we care about. And one check that this thing actually factors to here. So I certainly have this map, and the point is to prove that it factors through here. So now that means that we sort of get the map we want, okay, on generic supercuspidal. And this map L is characterized by the requirement that the Langland-Shahidi gamma factor for, so if you take a pi here, equal to the Galois theoretic one. So let's call phi pi image under L. For all irreducible representation tau of GLR, okay, for all R. Good boy. That's a good point. Sorry. So indeed.
Maybe not necessary.
No, not necessary. Indeed. So, you're absolutely right. Let me think for 1 second. Yes, you're absolutely right. Sorry. So, I should. Yeah, so I think you're right. I mean, I should say here it's just not irreducible, but you know, it'll be just semi-simple. Let me see. What was I saying? I want to say, okay, sorry. Multiplicity free, I think that's what I want to say. Multiplicity free. Okay. Indeed, so I should be more careful here. I mean, yeah, okay. So Yes, okay, so I don't mind just putting nothing here. Okay, firstly, that's okay. I never claim this map is bijective or surjective or anything. Okay, I just have a map. Under LLC, I will get something like that, right? And actually, all I want to say is that the image would factor through things which are conjugate dual. But I want to say that you don't have the lean part. You just have the bay part. And I want this to be elliptic. So just to create some space. Okay. So let's rewrite it here. L is characterized by. So this is okay. So I want something that belongs to the right set, and I want it to be elliptic. In other words, not it doesn't factor through any proper levy. Something has to be checked here. It's not automatic that this thing will take. You have to check it. Okay. But in fact, the main point of showing that it takes value in here comes down to this: the fact that when you construct this map, you show that it has this property, and this property uniquely characterizes it and also allow you to show that it takes image in such things. So in this property, this is a Langland-Shahidi gamma factor for the tensor product. I mean, of classical group and GL. Okay, this was one of the examples, right, of Langland-Shahidi gamma factor that I discussed last time. I remember I gave a couple of examples. One of them is this one, which corresponds to the Galois cycle tensor product. Okay, so thanks for the correction. It's kind of crazy statement. All right. Okay. Okay, so I think the point I want to make was that just from the Langland-Shahidi theory, you already got somehow a partially defined map, partially defined local Langlands correspondence, which is characterized by this type of property, that a certain representation theoretic invariant is compatible with a Galois theoretic one. And somehow what we want to do is to extend this map to all irreducible representations. Okay, so to do that, I need a hypothesis. Okay. Because as it's stated here, I just have a map. I never claim snow is surjective or anything. But I want to make a hypothesis, a working hypothesis. So suppose that my group is symplectic or orthogonal. So in a unitary case, I would not need this hypothesis. So basically, what I want to show is that a certain irreducible parameter, some irreducible parameter is in the image. Because at the moment, I know it factors through this set, right? But I don't know it's surjective. I don't know what things you get here. Okay, I think of things in here as an n-dimensional representation. Okay. So for example, suppose that h were SO2n plus 1. Okay. Then what I'm getting here are symplectic representation of the Vey group, right? Now, so the question is, you can write down by hand some symplectic representation of the Vey group, which is irreducible as a 2n-dimensional representation. Okay, so you have a certain element here, which as a representation is irreducible. And you can ask, is this in the image of that, this map? Okay, that's not immediately clear. Okay, so I want to put a hypothesis that it is. Okay, so another way to say is, you can say, I assume this map is surjective, for example. That's stronger than what I need, because I just need some irreducible parameter to be in the image. So then I want to assume. Almost irreducible pi. Pi is supposed to be why do I say almost irreducible? Basically, I want to say it's irreducible, but okay, so in fact, it's irreducible for HF equals to SO2N plus 1. Okay, so in this case, just to remind you, this is SP2NC or SO2N. In that case, L is O2N. But in fact, what I have in mind is a very specific parameter. This parameter is actually a tamely ramified parameter that you can write down by hand. But when the group is SP2N, when the L group is SO2N plus 1C, what you write down will not be this tamely ramified parameter that you construct by hand. It's not irreducible, but it breaks out as a one dimension plus a 2N dimensional irreducible. So that's why I call it almost irreducible. It's basically irreducible, okay? Except in the case of SP2N, where it is 2N dimensional plus 1 dimensional. So that's the working hypothesis. Now, why is this reasonable? Well, so first, I just need to remark. First, if local descent, maybe even global descent, is extended. So this is a local descent in the sense of Ginsburg, Raleigh's, Zhang, and Sidri. Okay. It's extended to function fields. Suppose you have this, then one would know that this LLS is surjective. Then the working hypothesis would be verified. Just the descent is basically allow you to start from some guy here and go back. So of course, in characteristic zero, this is essentially known, and if it works in the same way over function fields. And the second thing is that, in fact, you know, maybe you don't need such a strong thing because you care about some specific thinly ramified parameter. This parameter under local Langlands should correspond to a depth zero supercuspidal representation. So in characteristic zero, what happens is that, so in characteristic zero, to this phi, okay, there's a paper of debugger and reader which associates an L packet of depth zero supercuspidal. Then it was checked. So in this depth zero supercuspidal packet, there's one, there will be some generic ones, okay, and then it was checked by Gordon Savin. So Savin checked that for a supercuspidal high in this packet, for a generic supercuspidal in this packet, gamma LS of and as I said, this uniquely determines so on the other hand, this to this pi, right, you can apply that map and you also get a phi pi for which this relation holds. So you're going to get an identity of this gamma factor equal to this analogous one where phi is replaced by phi pi. And this allows you to deduce that phi is equal to phi pi. Okay. So in other words, we are saying that in characteristic zero, this hypothesis holds. Okay, that if you write down this tamely ramified parameter, it's a very specific one that you construct by hand, by induction from a one-dimension character over some extension field. Okay. And then it was checked that it will be in the image. Okay. And of course, one expects the same argument to hold. I checked with Gordon, Savin, and he said it should be okay, but since nobody bothers to write it down, so we just take it as a hypothesis. So anyhow, that's the... Okay, so since maybe before we take a break, let me just formulate the theorem. For unitary case, there's no need. You see, the reason why is because for a unitary case, but anyhow, you'll see later when I discuss the proof. Let's see. Then, there exists a map. Call it L again, from a irreducible representation of HF to L parameters. Such that so let's suppose pi goes to pi pi, such that a bunch of properties hold. Okay, so first is pi is discrete series, square integrable representation, if and only if pi pi is a elliptic, i.e. does not factor to any auto Levy sum. Pi is tempered if and only if pi pi is generic, then we have this equality of gamma factors. Okay. Now this is basically saying that an equivalent way of saying this is that that phi pi is LLS pi, namely, it agrees with what we had before. For general, pi mu of, so this is a functional measure that I use and is equal to the Galois theoretic one. This is just a shorthand for a bunch of products of Galois theoretic gamma factors. Okay. And finally, I want to say LL is compatible with Langland's classification. What do I mean by that? Well, suppose you have a non-tempered representation, then it is can be realized as uniquely as a Langland's quotient. And I want the map L to be compatible with this formation of Langland's quotient. This simply means that once you know how to define L for tempered, you can extend it to all representations in a natural way. Okay. And moreover, L is characterized by these properties. So that's the yeah, it's unfortunate that we have this working hypothesis, and I guess it's not impossible to try to verify it along the second point. And of course, because at this point, you see, this is not the end. I mean, this is a local Langland correspondence, but it leaves unanswered a number of questions. Let me just end with that. So one is this map L surjective? Nothing is said to that effect. Okay. Now, if you know the local descent, as I remarked over there, so that you know that this map from Langland-Shahidi is surjective, then you can show quite easily that this map is also surjective. E are the fibers. The fibers of this map are the so-called L packets. So are the fibers finite? It's not a priori clear. And you can ask, is there a refined cuspidation of the fibers in the usual way? So in the usual way means, for example, they are characters of some component group. Some questions that are not answered by this theorem. Okay, I think I take a 10-minute break. So let me start again. I mean, first I'll make a correction that in the remark I meant, of course, in characteristic zero, this hypothesis is okay. And secondly, I should say that this in this theorem, right, I'm working over a function field, right? So f is a local function field. And maybe let me take characteristic of f to be not true, because you know, for example, when I describe the classical group, it may be troublesome to go with quadratic form over characteristic 2 field. So I don't want to think about it, so let me assume that. And also, let me say that this hf, I assume is quasi-split, even though this is not so necessary, but in our paper, we just do that. Again, I wasn't trying to strive for maximal generality. I just want to show that something can be done. Okay, so, okay, now the next part I want to describe the proof of this. So the proof is basically, you know, so firstly, because of this property that is compatible with Langland's classification, basically, we just have to show this for tempered representation. And so also for tempered, because you know tempered are induced from discrete series, so it's basically easily reduced to discrete series. And that's the key case, okay? So to define this map for discrete series, we'll first do it for supercuspidal using a global argument, Lafforgue construction. Okay? And then how to extend this map from supercuspidal to discrete series? Well, we are going to use a Moglen and Tardich result. And their result, what they did was they classified discrete series representation of classical groups in terms of supercuspidal ones, in such a way that once you have the local Langlands map for supercuspidal, you can extend it to discrete series. However, their work was written for, in fact, both characteristic 0 and characteristic P. But it was written under some hypotheses. So in particular, there was a basic assumption in that work, which I will come to if I have time. And so what we did was we verified this basic assumption so that their work becomes unconditioned. Okay, so first let me talk about the supercuspidal case. You are given this supercuspidal representation of HF. So you find what you construct, let's say, and we construct a quasi split. I assume my HF was quasi split, right? H with a K with H V naught, which was HF. Here is where I'm going to use my working hypothesis. Playing baseball. Okay, so just now in my working hypothesis, I say that for a certain almost irreducible parameter phi 1, it is in a, you know, there is a supercuspidal, let's call it pi 1, such that you have an equality of gamma factors. So this pi 1 is S in the working hypothesis. This is the one who's under the L of LS gets sent to phi 1. An almost irreducible L parameter. Now, why didn't I need any working hypothesis when my group is a unitary group? Because then I can pick V1 to be a place such that the group HV1 is just GLN. It is split. And then I just take pi 1 to be any supercuspidal of GLN. That's why I don't need it. And then, of course, I want at all other places, pi V is in some principal series for all V. Maybe I don't need that. But so how do I know I can do all this? Well, that's what the global theorem tells me I can do. So I'm applying my to do this, I'm applying the globalization that I talked about in the first two talks. Once I get this pi, I apply Lafforgue's construction to give me a L-adic Galois representation. Now the point is to prove some properties of this L-adic. So this is the key proposition. What do we know about this? Well, at the place V1, I want to say that pi V1 correspond to, remember this pi 1 is a generic representation. And it is supercuspidal. Whatever it is, so it's as in the working hypothesis, so it is generic and supercuspidal. So I can apply this thing to it. Okay, so this is pi 1, right? And I want to say it is pi 1. Let me see. No, that's not what I want to say. No, what I want to say is this rho pi L. V1 is equal to pi. At V1, I look at the corresponding local Galois representation. Last time I mentioned that this is an L-adic, continuous L-adic representation of local Galois group, and by a standard procedure, you can transform it into a local Langlands parameter in the usual, in the sense I described. And after doing that, to Frobenius and simplify and everything, and you get this. So that's what I mean by this equality. Two, rho pi is a pure of weight zero. So what is this notion? Well, this is a notion that arises in, for example, in the Lin's work on the Bay vectors. But concretely, what it is saying is that at the unramified places, you have this L-adic Galois representation is almost everywhere is unramified. when you look at the Frobenius eigenvalue, okay, I guess what I should say, maybe you have to fit some isomorphism from here to C. So you look at the Frobenius eigenvalues, they are numbers inside here. And when you put them into C via this thing, they have complex absolute value 1. That's what the weight 0 is saying. But note that this is an almost everywhere condition, in the sense that this condition is about absolute value of Frobenius eigenvalues at the unramified places. Okay, so it is a condition on almost every place of your field, almost every close point on your curve. However, okay, the third part is at V naught, because this is after all what we care about. Rho pi L V naught is an elliptic. L parameter. So anyhow, this is a theorem, and at the moment, I state this provision. I'll make a few comments about it. And this is supplemented by the following another proposition for independence. Because at the moment, I haven't asserted that this elliptic parameter is just depends on pi v naught, which is pi f, right? So the notation is it basically is associated with this global Galois representation. But I want to check independence. So suppose I have the following data, k and k prime, over field, with two places, and h prime over k prime are two groups such that at these places they are the same, and pi prime are cuspidal representations of h prime respectively, such that at the place e naught it is the same as the pi prime, which is pi f. Rho pi l, and so to each of these, okay, I'm applying Lafforgue. Okay, to get that. Pure of weight 0. Then, when you extract the V naught prime component, they give the same L parameter. So this is making sure that this construction is independent of choices of globalization, choices of primes L, because you have to pick a L in Lafforgue's construction, you have to fix an L, and then L different from P, P being the residue, being the characteristic of your function field. And then, I didn't say that, so L prime are two primes, not equals to characteristic of L. Let me discuss the proof of this theorem. Okay, so the first statement in the first proposition is a statement about V1. We are going to examine at the place V1. Okay, so by the first proposition I talked about today was about this Poincare measure, right? If I have pi with rho pi, then for all V, the Poincare measure of pi V is described by some product of Galois theoretic gamma factors. Okay, that's what I want to use here. Okay, so by the result on Poincare measure, I know that mu of s pi 1 cos tau. Okay, so I'm looking at examining at V1, right? It's equal to mu. But let me write it out for one. Okay, so that seems write down everything for one time. Yeah, you have this, and you have ILV1. Okay, and then there's this, so this is the gamma factor for R1, so to speak, and then you have the one for R2, which has nothing to do with rho, just with tau. Okay, so here this R is basically symmetric square or exterior square or psi plus or minus, depending on which classical group you are. Right, so this was the thing that I had called rho pi L V1. Shorthand for that. So that was applying this result that I talked about at the beginning. On the other hand, this this is a locally defined thing. It's a composite of two local intertwining operators. Pi 1, so tau is for all tau, irreducible of some DLR for all R. Okay. All right. Now, of course, let me just take tau to be a supercuspidal. Okay. All supercuspidal. So then both these representations are generic. So by Langland-Shahidi, Langland-Shahidi theory says, I mentioned this also when I talk about Poincare measure, which in the generic case, this thing is a product of Langland-Shahidi gamma factors. Because that's what Langland-Shahidi theory does. It refines this invariant. Okay. So it basically, analogous product of four terms. Okay, but it's analogous four terms, but for this Langland-Shahidi gamma factor. Okay. On the other hand, know by the working hypothesis that this guy is, now I'm going to use my shorthand, for pi 1 cross pi. So that was the property that we imposed, right? This guy goes correspond to that guy, and in such a way that the gamma factor match up. Now, of course, here I also have this gamma factor, or one of these guys, this is Langland-Shahidi and I have to replace them by the Galois theoretic one. So how do I know they are equal? Because local Langland's correspondence for GLN, well, it reflects this L function that was proved by Henya. Well, okay, it reflects these gamma factors that was proved by almost, right? So Henya showed that L functions are preserved. These L functions are preserved, and epsilon factors are preserved up to some roots of unity. So a priori, this guy is equal to the Galois theoretic one up to some roots of unity. However, when you put these two together, the roots of unity cancels. All right. So anyhow, you have this. So the point now is you compare these two sides. I mean, because this thing is equal to two, so you get this is equal to that. You will cancel this one because it's the same guy on both sides. So you're going to get an identity that say this thing is equal to the analogous thing, but with the rho replaced by phi 1. Okay? And for all irreducible representation of the pay group of E, let's say. And this will allow you to, you want to say that this equation allow you to show that rho and phi 1 are the same. Well, you know that this cannot be true because, in general, because you know, gamma factors only depends on because of multiplicativity, it only depends on the supercuspidal support of your representation. So you can take two irreducible components of the same induced representation. These gamma factors will not be able to tell them apart; they will look identical. But those two representations could have different L parameters. For example, you can take trivial representation and Steinberg representation. Gamma factors look the same. So there's no way, so anyhow, from this we get, you're going to get, okay, I'm going to simplify my, drop those subscripts, okay? You're going to get something like that. So just the same expression except rho has been replaced by phi 1. Okay, and the question is, does this force rho be equal to phi? So in general, I say this is no, right? Because I say if you, in general, no. But because phi 1 is almost irreducible, okay, just pretend it is irreducible, then the answer is yes. So for example, let me just talk it through. Suppose it is irreducible. Then, you know, when you take this guy is some irreducible representation, right? Irreducible representation of the Bethe-Lee group. Suppose this is irreducible of dimension n, let's say. Now, when you take this to be an irreducible of dimension less than n, okay, but this is irreducible, you see that this side will have no either zeros or poles at s equals to zero. Okay? Then this would mean that this side also wouldn't have zeros or poles. And this would say that this rho cannot contain any irreducible summands of dimension less than n. Okay? On the other hand, of course, if you take this rho phi to be phi 1 itself, then you will see that you have some poles here or zeros, okay? Either at s equals to zero or s equals to 1. Because this thing is basically 1 minus s of phi 1 check this, right, over ls. Okay, and this term will be a similar one, but 1 plus S. So you know when this L vector is at poles on Dolan poles. So if I want an irreducible and you take something of dimension less than that dimension of phi 1, then suppose you take S equals to 0, okay, then the numerator is harmless. The denominator will have, you know, in principle, you will have pole at S equals to 0 if this is equal to that. Or these two are dual of each other. Okay. But if this is irreducible of dimension n, you take something of dimension less than n, you see that there will be no holes in the denominator. So there's no zeros at S equals to 0. Similar, then this would force this other side not to have it. Okay. Yeah, no, not just at S equals to 0. In fact, you will have no poles essentially anywhere. Okay. Whereas if the rho has some summon, zero is a representation of Wedderlin group. Okay. So if it has some summon whose dimension is less than n, or if it has some, the SL2 in the way the lean has X non-trivially somewhere, you're going to create poles somewhere. Okay, so this is the type of argument that you use to show that because of this almost irreducible condition, in fact, this equation for all tau forces them to be equal. Yeah. Okay, so now, so that proves, this proves part one, right? After part one, you would know that you would know that so after one, then you see that this global representation is almost irreducible, right? Because, for example, because you know that one of its local component is just something irreducible. So that is the global one, you know, even more irreducible, so to speak. Now, okay, so for part two, this actually follows by a conjecture made by Berlin in A2. And which has been shown by Laurent Lafforgue in his work on the global Langlands correspondence for GLN. And what does this conjecture say? This big conjecture basically say that if rho is irreducible, then it is pure. I guess here because we're starting from some, say, classical group with the determinant is basically zero, I mean, no trivial, okay. So it's, from this, you see, it has to be a weight, a zero, from the central character. So this basically, central character is unitary. It's pure with zero. So this is, in some sense, just providing a big input. And the third one is, well, you see, you know this Galois-Gernsheim is pure. Okay. And as I said, this pureness is an almost everywhere condition. It's, on the automorphic side, you will be saying that suppose I have a cuspidal representation. At almost all places, the local component is tempered. Does it mean that at the remaining places, the local component must be tempered? Well, ideally, yes. Okay, you have to say yes. But I don't think this is something that is known. I don't know of a result that says that it is. Okay? But in the Galois theoretic setting, this condition is basically temperedness. But the answer is yes, and this was shown by Berlin. So in day two, that
L.V.
Is a tempered parameter. Of course, in his theorem, he doesn't use this terminology, but if you write down what unravel what he says, so that's so you see that it was crucial to so the main thing was to get this global Galois representation to be irreducible. Okay? Because then after that you just apply this to theorem. And how do you get it to be irreducible? You get it to be irreducible by forcing one of its Galois local Galois representation to be irreducible. That's why you have that working hypothesis. Because it's just a Galois representation. So we're just saying that this Galois representation is tempered. But now you have to show that it is elliptic L parameters for HF, which means you must show that this guy is conjugate dual of the right sign, right? Okay. Let me see why this is an issue, because it now it's when I look at it now, it seems to me that I know that this rho I L is some thing to the, you know, the relevant if I take the local component, it seems to me that it should be automatically sort of the right type. Yeah. Okay. Okay, but I have to check it is elliptic. Okay. So I only know it is tempered at the moment. So I still need to check. This guy is elliptic, which means that as a representation, it is multiplicity free sum of irreducible summands or self conjugate dual of the same sign. And I want to show this. Okay, so let me say how it is done. Okay. So, of course, you still have this relation about punctual measure and gamma vectors at the place. You have it at all places, so particularly at V0. So you have a relation of the punctual measure for our representation pi f in terms of some Galois theoretic gamma factor for this guy. And what is your goal? Your goal is to show that So you see, once you know that it's a tempered L parameter, what does it mean as a representation? It means that it is the, when you break it up into irreducibles, let me see. Yeah, so when you look, so let's say this is supposed to be a symplectic representation. Okay? But when you break it into irreducible, the irreducible summand can be of three types. It could be symplectic, or it could be orthogonal, but in that case, it must occur with even multiplicities. Or it is just not self-dual at all, in which case its dual has to appear as well. What you would like to do to show that it's elliptic is to rule out the last two types. You want to show that every irreducible summand is symplectic. So it means you want to show that it cannot contain any orthogonal and it cannot contain any non-self-dual. Okay? And you are going to use this same identity about to help you do that. Okay. How? Okay. So you have that identity, but at the place B0 instead of B1. Now you have to use some properties of punctual measure, because you have to use something about it. Right? So one of the properties is the following. If you take I1 and tau, let's say they are discrete series, which they are in fact supercuspidal. Then, let me see what I want to say. So if tau is not conjugate self-dual, okay, then this function, will not have a zero at, I think, s equals to zero. Okay. So this is a property of punctual measure that is known. I mean, it was shown in Watts-Berger's paper on punctual measure, where he gave a detailed proof of Harishchandra's work on the decomposition of L. Maybe I'll write it down. Okay, but let me say first. On the other hand, if you take tau to be conjugate dual of the okay. No. So yes. Okay. So I'm stating some properties of Poincare measure. If you take tau to be non-conjugate dual, this guy has no zeros at s equals to zero. If you take tau to be conjugate dual, then I guess the zeros at order at most two. It could be at zero, it could be at another point, depending on whether you are conjugate dual of sine plus or minus, okay, depending on the situation. But the zeros is at most of order two. And the consequence of this, after you, so you know these facts about Poincare measure. And you say, what does it say about the right-hand side? Okay, and what you would say is that this row, it cannot contain any non-conjugate dual summons. Okay, that's from the first fact. And the second fact is that, from the second fact about the orders, you know, the zeros, you know, order at most two, when tau is conjugate dual, will tell you that it must be multiplicity free. Okay, the reason is because, suppose it's not multiplicity free, say, a certain phi tau occurs two times. Then, on the first gamma factor, you are going to get some zeros of order two already. But the other guy, the one with the minus s, will also have this zero of order two. So you'll get zero order four. So that cannot happen, so you get this. It's a bit technical to write down, but so the remaining 10 minutes, I want to so this basically completes the case for supercuspidal. So okay, as I said, this is I'm going to write down these properties that I have just used for functional measure. This is a property of mu. So I'm considering this is my representation of H. This is by some GLR. Looking at the individual for a classical group. So so these two guys are unitary. Stochastic. So So what does the lemma say? So first, if tau is not conjugate, so this C is just a Galois group of E over F. Okay, so it's not relevant unless you are talking about unitary group. Forget about unitary group, just look at symmetric orthogonal. There's no C, it's just saying it's not self-dual. So if it's not self-dual, then this is irreducible for all X. If and only if mu 0 in which case sorry, I can't remember any of these things, so I have to look is pi cross tau is irreducible for all s in Rails. S is a real number in this lemma. And mu S I cross tau is holomorphic. So the upshot is you have a criterion of when it reduces when at zero. You know whether this guy vanishes or not. And once you know it reduces at zero, it cannot reduce everywhere else. There's just one point of reducibility. Suppose it is self-dual, and the functional measures vanish at zero. So in fact, it is irreducible, right? Then, whether it's irreducible or not. Reducible, if and only if there's a pole. There is a unique such S not bigger than zero. So in this case, it is irreducible as zero. But there's a unique point of reducibility in a positive S. Of course, a minus S naught is also reducible. And the pole of mu at S naught is simple. Okay. And okay, so I think it's here. So you have a double zero at zero. You have a simple pole at some positive S naught as well as minus S naught. But every other place you are holomorphic non-vanishing. And this unique pole is the place where it has a pole is the point of reducibility. Okay, so this lemma. So the nature of this lemma is just saying that the properties, the analytic properties of this functional measure tells you quite a bit about reducibility points of this induced representation in the case when the inducing data is supercuspidal. Okay? And this result is basically Harish-Chandra. Harish-Chandra, and part of it is Sweeberger. So for example, this uniqueness of the reducibility point is a result of Sweeberger. I had used you know, this property just now, right? Because just now I I should add here in this here that in this case that the mu has no poles or zero. So I will use this property earlier when I showed the elliptic, the fact that the parameters elliptic. Okay, but anyhow, the point of this lemma is to show the following proposition. So if pi is supercuspidal and phi pi is L pi, because now we have defined a map L pi on supercuspidal, then the L parameter of a supercuspidal representation is not arbitrary. There's some special property. Then call some proof is without holes. Okay, so what does it mean? So just to define this term, so you can write phi pi. You can decompose into irreducible pieces, right? So the irreducible piece will look something like that. So this is a irreducible representation of the Bay group. This thing is some irreducible representation of SL2. Because the Bay Dalin group is a product of Bay group. So for each row, okay, the row is like row I, okay, so let you set job row pi pi to be the set of A such that rho tensor SA. So this is the RI dimensioner. So we know representation of SL2 for every positive integer, there's one. Okay, so it's contained in five. So basically, you look at all these factors, you pick out all those with the same rho, and you collect all these numbers together. Okay. And to say that it has no holes, even only under this definition. So if even only if you have some A in implies that A minus 2 also like that. So I guess the point is, so for example, you cannot have cannot just have this because there's a hole here. Because you should have rho tensor S5. Okay, all these things are maybe I'm assuming rho is conjugate to rho. Okay. I mean, it will be conjugate to rho in this case because I have a supercuspidal. Rho is conjugate to rho here. So all these numbers have the same parity, either all odd or even. So this will be something with a hole because you're stepping every two steps, then you will drop into the river. But if you put in this thing, then it looks like it has no holes. Right? So you want this for all rows. So maybe I can take 5 minutes to finish the proof of this. And because once you have this, you'll be immediate that a corollary of this is that is the following, that I S not tau tensor pi is reducible if and only if. So okay, by the lemma we have so these are all supercuspidal, right? So by the lemma we know we have some control of where reducibility happens if you understand something about functional measure. And this proposition will allow us to have this control. So firstly, you need this to be that, and one of the following. S naught is A tau I plus 1 over 2 is bigger than 1 with A tau I equals to the maximum of the pi is empty. If it is not empty, then you have a maximal element, and that will be the point. There's only one reducibility point, you know, s bigger than 0, so equal to 0. And opposite of, so this is the sign of it's not the local number. Okay. I mean, so this sign is positive if this is the orthogonal representation, and it's minus if it is symplectic. You can see these two reducibility point comes from the pole of gamma factor for this asymmetric square or exterior square, L function part. Okay, and the point of stating this corollary is that this corollary, this assumption, EA, basic assumption in Moglen and Tardich paper. So this corollary verifies that basic assumption, and then their work becomes unconditional, and this once they become unconditional, you can extend this map from supercuspidal to discrete series. Okay, so because since I run out of time, I will not write down the proof of this. Let me just say that, yeah, anyhow, maybe let me not even say anything. So I'll just say for the last lecture, which is next year, yes, what I plan to do is I will give an exposition of Lafforgue's construction of this global Galois representation from a cuspidal type. Because so far I have been using it as a black box, but I think that it is it's good to see exactly what goes into the proof of that theory. That's all I do. Thank you.
Measure in terms of the product of the so you can look at the functional, you look at the functional measure for pi cross tau, let's say. What is tau? Tau is pi cross rho. If you have rho, right? Rho, you fix rho such that the Jordan rho by pi is not empty. Then you want to prove that it has this property. A is inside, A minus 2 is inside. Right? So rho will determine a supercuspidal representation tau rho GL. Then you can look at the functional measure for pi cross tau rho. By what we have shown for the supercuspidal case, we know this functional measure is expressed in terms of some Galois theoretic gamma factors. Then now, you look at where this product of gamma factors could have poles. I guess you look at poles, that's you. I think that's how. It's hard to say without writing it down, I think. So if you write it down and stare at it, it's you write down this identity for functional measure equals the product of gamma factors. You examine what are the possible poles that could happen. And yeah, that will tell you. And then you combine with this lemma, which tells you that you know you have some information about what are the possible zeros and poles of the of mu. Maybe you don't know exactly where it is, but you have some control. You have, like, for example, zeros is of order at most two, and, you know, there's at most one place where there's pole, things like that.